I'm Finn.
I'm Sori.
That's Sparky.
And Salty and Chip.
So we're reviewing Ghosts, and it's Carice?
I'm gonna go with Circle because it looks like Circle.
Carice?
But it's not.
Sirishi?
I don't know.
Cersei?
I'm sure you guys will let us know.
Yeah. Actually! So yeah.
Honestly, I think it's cute when you guys let us know when we're wrong. I think it's cute.
Yeah, I'm still holding my ground on Schism. It's Schism, so I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm very interested in this.
Really? I'm going with Schism. That's what I see when I look at it.
Well, I know. That's because you're a commoner. It's really Schism.
Okay.
You are a schismatic.
I can say something right now, but I'm going to hold it in.
A heretic. That's good you didn't say that. Or people would have been angry at you.
I know. That's why I only told you. Are you angry at me?
Nope. I'm completely fine. I agree. All right, let's go. Okay. Ghost.
Oh, whoa. All right, we're ready.
Yeah. Yeah, looks like Silence of the Lambs.
Go. You're in trouble now.
See that you're lost without me. can feel the thunder that's breaking in your heart. I can see through the scars inside you. I can feel the thunder that's breaking in your heart. I can see through.
This is a devil band, you know that, right?
Wait, the pseudo devil band?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So now you're a fan of Ghost or you're a fan of this song?
I'm a fan of this song.
Feel the thunder that's breaking
in your heart.
Okay, what do you think the song was about?
Well, to me it just sounds like that there's a person that's going through some stuff and they're breaking and their heart is breaking inside, and then someone else comes along and like can see through that and can hear the heartbreak that's going on inside them. Like other people might not, to them it's as loud as a thunder, but to the rest of the world just overlooks it, but that person can really see like inside of them and understand them. And
yeah, but the understanding person is a devil.
I don't know.
I feel your presence amongst us. You cannot hide in the darkness. That's the devil.
It may or may not be.
You just don't want it to be the devil.
No.
That's a good angle. I never thought about that.
What?
The thunder in your heart. So, like, you've got all this loud crashing shit going on in your soul, but nobody hears it.
But one person can. And one person can. It's as loud as the thunder.
Yeah.
Yeah. What?
So then the devil. Yeah, it's the devil.
No.
Because look, I know your soul is not tainted, even though you've been told so.
Yeah.
That's original sin. We tell everybody that they're tainted.
Or it could just be a relationship, and everybody tells them that they're a fuck up, except for that one person.
You just don't want to admit it's the devil.
No, I don't. I was happy thinking of it something else.
Oh boy, it's the devil.
No.
Yeah, I think this is the devil taking advantage of like some lonely person. And saying, hey, I hear you, I understand, I see the scars.
And it was a happy, nice love song, I thought.
Yeah, and it says, well, yeah, it's still a love song.
Now there's nothing between us.
Yeah, now the merge is eternal. That's the devil, my dude.
No.
That's Beelzebub.
No, no.
That's Hasatan.
No.
Al-Shaytan. Iblis. How many other words do I have to say?
No, I disagree with you. I don't care how many points you come up with, that's not what it is.
That's the devil.
No.
Now the merge is eternal.
No.
So like that's the thing with like people like that.
I mean, that's what's going on in this picture, it looked like.
Yeah.
It's this girl with dark hair.
Yeah, and there's like a bee, and then there's the guy looks that like means, a Sith Lord.
I've never seen a bee with butterfly wings like that.
He looks like a Sith Lord from, yeah. What do you call it?
I mean, he's got blue eyes. Nobody with blue eyes can be bad.
Right, right. But she has red eyes, so...
No, those are brown.
She's still evil.
Your eyes are basically that color.
No, she has red eyes. I'm not... But
no, your eyes are brown. That's like this reddish brown.
See, every time I listen to Ghost, I always think these guys have, even though people keep saying, oh, it's just a joke, like, to me, they seem to be more familiar with Satan's operations than Watain or Behemoth, like, by a mile. Like, this is the shit that the devil actually does. Like, even though they're joking about it or whatever, like, this to me, like...
Well,
this is the playbook, for sure.
If it's literally talking about the devil, then actually it's kind of creepy. I want to say like subtle, the subtlety.
Right. He was more subtle
than... better word than that, but...
No, but that's the word, right? Yeah, he was more subtle than all the beasts of the field.
Yeah.
So, you know, like that's how he operates. And then at the end, can't you see that you're lost without me?
Yeah.
Like, that's how the devil operates.
Creepy.
And if you expand the devil to, like, just being the archetypical, you know, if we go the Jordan Peterson angle and say he's the accumulation of what we understand as psychological evil, right? Mm-hmm. And we personify it. Then, like, the dude who always is able to take advantage of the outsider or the girl or the whatever... Yeah. The dude who can sit back and watch and know but the signs of a person who feels rejected is and then how to take advantage of that and then control that person. Like, that's the devil. Like, that type of tactic. And that's like the tactic that you see here is he plays up on this person's feeling of isolation and feeling of, you know, exclusion and feeling
and
of self
scarred.
And self-pity.
Yeah. Yep. Well, if you come from the devil angle, I can see where you're seeing that. It makes a lot of sense.
Well, but there are certain elements in our society who make a very big deal about victimization. And they keep selling certain groups in our culture victimization.
Yeah.
And then those groups are like, oh, okay, somebody cares about me. When in reality, they're just doing that so they can exploit them politically.
Oh, right. Yeah. I'm like, right? What are you talking? Oh, yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. So all this, like, identity for sure. Politics bullshit... Like, none of these people are struggling in the ghetto. None of these people are struggling in the hood.
Yeah.
Bernie Sanders isn't living in the ghetto.
Right.
But, like, a lot of these politicians, like, they will use that sense of self-pity that people have. Never to, like, get them empowered out of that situation. Mm-hmm. But so that now you're completely reliant on me, which is, like, mm-hmm. what he talks about. Without me, you're lost.
Yeah.
So... First, you have this, like, eternal merge, right? Like, oh, there's nothing in between us. And then the very next thing is you're lost without me. So now you're completely dependent on this person. Because all they did was talk about, like, you know, feed your self-pity.
Yeah.
And feed your victim narrative. And they did nothing to empower you to be able to stand on your own 2 feet.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, so, I see that.
And I'm not saying that people aren't victims. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying... Okay, what do you do with victimization?
Mm-hmm.
What do you do with being an outsider? What do you do with all that pain in your heart? Like, what do you do with it? And he's not really giving her or him anything to as a solution.
Well, what would be your solution? I mean, I think that according to human nature, I think it's pretty natural for people to have self-pity. Unless you're Ben.
No, I think self-pity is one of the earliest... That's why right after Genesis, when you start hearing about human nature...
Yeah.
Genesis 3. The very next story in the narrative of Genesis 4,
mm-hmm.
where Cain is basically an exercise in self-pity.
Yeah.
He does the wrong thing. God doesn't accept his offering. God accepts the offering of his brother. Mm-hmm. He gets pissed off. He feels sorry for himself.
Right.
He's mad at God. He's mad at his brother. He kills his brother. Then God confronts him. And then God says, okay, this is going to be your punishment. And then Cain goes, the punishment's more than I can bear.
Yeah.
So Cain is just a big, big case study in self-pity.
Yeah.
And it's literally the very next sin that gets isolated in the Bible. The first is like, pride in our deciding, we're going to decide what's right or wrong, right? That's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Yep.
And then the very next thing is self-pity. And self-pity can actually lead you to murder someone.
Right. Well, that's what it did, yeah.
Which is like that communist guy yesterday, where like there's all this pity about, oh, we're downtrodden by these evil capitalists, so what's the solution? Not to, you know, pull yourself up by your bootstraps and make it work in a capitalist economy. No, we need to kill a bunch of capitalists.
Yeah, right, right.
You know, self-pity will lead you to murder people.
And this guy's saying it like it's a completely sane thought that he has.
Well, yeah, Jamal's like, how many people have to die? Thousands? And the guy goes, whatever. Millions? Whatever. Billion? Whatever.
The guy's literally insane.
Yeah.
That is the definition of insanity.
But that, but the root of that is when you combine pride and self-pity, you can get in trouble with that. And there are people in our society that know how to harness that and turn it into really dangerous shit. It's the same thing happened with the Germans. You know, they get their asses kicked in World War I. Mm-hmm. There's this horrible punitive Treaty of Versailles that basically destroyed the German economy and way of life. Mm-hmm. So there's all this German self-pity, and then boom, here comes Adolf Hitler. So he harnessed all that self-pity.
You're right.
Created a bad guy, and then boom. So like here, like here's, you know, the serpent coming around and like on an individual level doing the same shit. Like, oh, I feel your pain, I hear you, blah, blah, blah. Like, you gotta be careful about people in your life that are constantly feeding you victim narratives and constantly presenting themselves as a solution and never doing anything to empower you, you know, within yourself. To be able to get out of that situation. Because they act like they're really caring, but in reality...
they're just trying to control you?
They are controlling. So, which of course... okay, so here's the irony of this whole thing, right? This is the devil. But a lot of churches are like this. Right? Like, a lot of churches are very... I'll pour you, blah, 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 and never tell you anything you don't want to hear. And it's like, you know, that's how a lot of, you know, oh, come to us and we'll solve all your problems and da-da-da-da. And, like, there really isn't anything like... like, if you read Jesus straight through in the gospel, this is one of the things I appreciate about Aaron Roth, was that I had a conversation with somebody a couple weeks ago, and he was basically saying, oh, the stuff Jesus said was great. And I quoted some of the stuff Jesus said. He's like, I never read that before. Mm-hmm. Like, Aaron Ra was like, Jesus said some really funky shit. Like, but see, Jesus wasn't about, like, you know, pitying you and making you wallow in your self-pity. So there's a lot of times that he'd speak for the poor and the widow, and then on the other side he'd say, you fucked up here. You know, and people are like, wait a second, you're supposed to be on my side. So, like, if you have somebody in your life that's, like, constantly on your side all the time and never said anything to piss you off or challenge you, then you can be sure that that's what's going on. Like, and say in churches are like that. Like, they'll make sure they say things that never piss anybody off so people keep coming to them so that they're never confronted with the internal conflict that's going to spur on actual change.
Wow. Well, I think that a lot of times, if your focus is money, you know what I mean? Then it kind of affects how you're going to say things. I mean, there's stuff that we say on our channel that are hard things that you know not everybody's going to like, but we're saying it to help people, not because we're like, oh, well, you know, we're the smartest and we have the best opinions and blah, blah, blah. But it's that we believe what we're saying and that's why we're saying it. And if we could say all the right things to get all the subscribers and, you know what I mean? Like, and we could, you know, situate things where we could make the most money, but it's not about that for us. It's about giving people the truth because we want people to be helped and to be able to help themselves, so.
And we want to learn. So, like, anytime I get in a real conflict with somebody when a person actually engages me, I always end up saying,
I learned something from that conversation.
Well, yeah, I always did. I always do. So, like, you know, but everybody kind of wants, see, this is the thing, like, on the outside, when you're observing, you can go, oh, shit, this is really manipulative shit.
Yeah.
But at the same time, everybody wants one of these people in their lives.
Yeah. Everybody wants somebody to understand them.
Well, it's not about, like I said, I get it.
But
like,
you're saying it's the whole, like, you're lost without me
stuff. Well, exactly. Like, you're lost without me. Like, you're completely dependent on the person.
Yeah.
right?
Yeah, we don't want that.
Now, if you can pull off a 3-day resurrection, then I'll grant it, like, okay, that's a person that you need to depend on. Right? Like, so, like, if you can die and predict that you're going to die and then rise from the dead 3 days later, I'd say, okay, that guy, okay, fine. Depend on that guy and you're lost without him. But other than that, there's some, like, serious shit that you're... No, seriously.
Oh, we always believe that the Antichrist is going to die and then get raised a couple days later. So what you just said, we'd be like, what? You idiot, why would you do that?
I was actually describing Jesus.
I know you were, but...
but your theology was so whack that you... God almighty. But you know what's really interesting is, you know, like... I guess this must have been one of their biggest songs, because as soon as we did Ghost, this is everybody the song says, that everybody
yeah.
wanted.
Yeah.
So it's like... We were having our walk last night or this morning, whatever it was, and I was just... You know, because we get to talk to people, and people start telling us things in your life. And I was just blown away by how much pain people are in the world. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's mind-boggling, you know. And I think that, you know, manipulators get to feast on people because not enough people actually care about other people.
Oh, you're completely right. I totally agree with that statement.
But then at the same time, it's... Okay, is it that people just don't care about other people, or is it people are in so much that
yeah.
they're having such a hard time with their own shit that they're having a hard time?
Or they haven't really been through anything, so they can't even sympathize with other people that have been through painful things.
Right.
You know, I look back, you know, when I was a teenager and... You know, of course, I grew up in a Christian home, and so, like, and I was very, like, a strong type of person, so people would come to me and tell me their problems. Man, I hadn't been through a friggin' thing. Now I look back at some of the things that I said that I thought was helpful to people, and I'm like, oh my gosh. Like, that probably made that person's situation worse.
Yeah, sometimes people will say things that I'm like...
Insensitive.
I'm like, I have no... Like, I'll look at the phone, and I'm like... Because people understand, like, you know, we're two people and there's 30,000 people on our channel. Mm-hmm. So they know that it's not like we can
answer all of them.
But some things are just like, I don't know what to say. Because, like, we've been through enough things with people in the real world where it's like, there have been so many times when you didn't say anything to anybody, you just hugged them. But on a virtual...
Yeah, I know.
A virtual context, you can't do that. But I think people know that, you know, you love them. And I think, you know, oddly enough, the solution to falling into one of these traps is to have a community around you, right? Mm-hmm. Of people who really do love you. But the problem is that, you know, that's what the church was supposed to be. Like, that was the original mm-hmm. design of, you get a bunch of hurting people who are like, you know, if you get enough people together, you can kind of bear each other's burden, as the mm-hmm. scripture says. And carry each other when you're going through a rough time. But it's become something else. Like, mm-hmm. the church has become something else, you know. So. Mm-hmm.
It's tough, because sometimes I just want to reach through the phone and...
Yeah. Yeah, people are going through... Yeah, it was just like one of those, like, mind-blowing moments when you just stop and think about how much pain is in the world and how much pain people are carrying. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Sometimes I'll say, I'm sending a sorry hug, but it seems so, like, it's letters on a keyboard, and it's not, like, it doesn't, you know, some people, I feel like they just need just a genuine hug, and you can't pass that through text messages. And...
Yeah, but I think they know that. I think after hanging out with us for 3 months, they pretty much know what type of people.
Yeah.
Type of person you are, you know, so... But yeah, you know, I can feel the thunder that's breaking your heart. That's, lyrically, these guys are pretty crazy.
I liked it.
Because, you know, can you hear the thunder that's breaking, which is sort of like, can you recognize that a person's got this internal mm-hmm. conflict, but then later on it says, I can feel the thunder that's breaking in your heart.
Well, see, like, for me, like, I thought of that, you know, that summer that you were having a hard time, you know, and like, all of a sudden, like, I could feel your heart. Like, it was weird. Like, I could feel, like, almost like my heart was breaking, like, when I could feel your heart breaking. So, like, that part made, you know, like, I was thinking about the friendship angle of, like, having that friend that can feel the thunder that's breaking in your own heart. And see through the scars inside you. You know what I mean? Like, that's what I was thinking when I saw it. Because there was...
Yeah, that was a rough...
Yeah.
It was a rough time.
Yeah, there was, you were so closed off.
Well, I had a lot of people depending on me.
Yeah.
So.
I know, yeah.
What do you give the song?
Honestly, I'm giving it a 9, and I would have given it a higher score. I really enjoyed the whole thing. Of course, it's a little bit creepy now that, you know, I hear your interpretation of it, like... yeah. But I would have given it a 10, except that, you know, it kind of reminded me of that other song that we were like, okay, are we gonna, we're gonna say, oh, we're going with the same line again, okay.
So
it was a bit repetitive, I thought.
Well, this seems to be their radio song, so.
What do you mean?
It's like a radio song. It's a song you put out for the radio.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Probably the other one was, too.
Yeah.
I really like that Trivium song we heard the other day. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so, yeah, I'm getting
a 9. Ask them about it when we talk to them. It's a 6 for me.
Why? You didn't really like it? It was basic to you?
Yeah, I mean, there's... Yeah.
I liked it.
I mean, musically, I thought it was...
It was catchy.
Nah, it's still a 6. It's a 6 for me.
You almost gave it a liar.
Yeah. It's a 6 for me. So you give it a 9?
I give it a 9,
yeah. It's crazy, a 9.
I really enjoyed it, though. But it meant more to me than it... Well, if I thought start to finish it was about the devil, then it would have probably changed my opinion, because it made it a little bit creepy, especially at the beginning when you were saying...
You didn't see our merge is eternal?
I just thought that was like really good friends now. Sometimes I'm so naive.
You're so sweet.
I feel your presence amongst us. You cannot hide in the darkness. That I was kind of like...
That didn't tip you off that was Shaitan.
Well, it was a little bit weird, but then I quickly forgot about it when it got into the, you know, it was, I was like, oh, that's so nice. You know, like they understand each other.
Good old Satan.
No, I didn't think Satan. I stopped thinking, you know, obviously hiding in darkness makes you think of the devil, but that's really creepy when you think about, you know, like, you think about people that, you know, struggle with suicidal thoughts or different things like that. Like, it kind of comes to some, I don't know about everybody, but, you know, like, some people, it kind of comes to them slowly, and it's just kind of like a thought that's there. It kind of brings, like, some comfort to them. And that's kind of like that's hiding in the darkness, you know what I mean? Like that kind of slow creeping in. And then like, man, like the devil can really start feeding off that with you, and it can really turn into something if you let it. So it's just, I don't know, when you think about this coming from the devil angle, it's like, whoa, like.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
yeah,
these,
I know,
these guys are much better at, even if they're not a satanic band, these guys are much better at like tactically how the devil operates in Watain or Behemoth or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it was an enjoyable song.
Then out.
3 out.
Gone.
There's nothing between us. From now our merge is eternal. Can't you see that you're lost? Can't you see that you're lost without